So, Father, bottom line, here we are in the name of Jesus. We are helpless without you. And we, Father, are desperate, in need of your presence and your power and the revelation of your word. Because, sir, without it, we pass through life and we fail at everything. We may gain a whole lot of material things, make us feel good about ourselves, but at the end of life, we're obviously not taking one of them with us. We want to serve you all the days of our life. That's why we're here tonight, to grow, become healthy, strong in Jesus, that the rest of the world may fall and fail, but we keep going on. So cause the Word of God, Holy Spirit, to become alive on the inside of us, and we'll give you the praise and the glory and all the honor. Bless all the churches in the Inland Empire that are meeting tonight and that are preaching and hearing the Word of God. We love them, Lord. They're our brothers and sisters. They may not go to this church. They may have a church that's different than ours and its approach to you, but that doesn't matter. What's important is if their hearts are with you. And so that's what makes them brothers and sisters. We ask you to bless them as well as you would bless us this night. In Jesus' mighty name, with a great big shout, we say amen. Amen. Go ahead and have a seat. Take your Bible. Go with me once again to Matthew, the 16th chapter. You know, all my life of teaching for 40 years has always been line upon line, precept upon precept. When I go preach different places, I preach topics and things like that. But I study that way. That's the way I look at the Word of God. Is I don't just take a little verse from here and a verse from there and a verse from here and put it together. And that's fine if you do that. It's not saying that's wrong. But what I do, I'm different maybe from some people, is I take in line upon line, so I have to digest everything, because I believe, hopefully you do too, that this is the inspiration of God. That means everything that's written here, I don't care who physically wrote it, I know the author of all the books are all the same. It's the Holy Spirit. And it's by inspiration that the Word of God is written. And I believe that, and because I believe that, I don't have to evaluate who and when and where and under what conditions it was written. I just know if God has preserved the Word for thousands of years for us, at the cost of many people's lives, then it has value, and I need to take the Word of God in and make it part of my life, and then literally make my choices in life. And I want to say that one more time. Make my choices in life based on what the Bible says, not based on what the heck I feel. Because one day I could feel really good about something. The next day I find myself could give a flip about it. Is anybody there with me? It's like, guy, this. And the more you know about Jesus, the less you're really interested in the things of this world. And it's almost, if you don't know anything but the things of this world, it can be really frustrating. This is such a fascinating time in the Word of God in Matthew, the 16th chapter. I think tonight you'll be fascinated as we study the Word of God. Let me tell you where we left off. If you remember this, Jesus comes to his disciples and he says, who do men say that I am? Do you remember that? And they say, oh man, you're Moses, or you're Elijah, or you're the prophet, or you're, you know, John the Baptist, or you're, you know, and none of them were correct in what they said. But then he says, and who do you say, speaking to his disciples, who do you say I am? No one speaks up but Peter. Peter speaks up and he says, you are the Christ. Remember that in verse number 16 of the 16th chapter, you are the Christ, the Son, and it's an amazing revelation, the Son of the living God. And it actually catches Jesus' attention. Because he wasn't just the Christ, he wasn't just the deliverer, he wasn't just the prophet, he wasn't just a person, he wasn't just a good man, he wasn't a teacher like many people said. Peter nailed it. You are the Christ, the Messiah, the Son of the living God. And then Jesus stops and he looks at Peter and he says, Peter, he really says, Simon Bar-Jonah, that was his name. He says, you're Peter. And upon this revelation, the rock of revelation of who I am, this revelation that I am the Christ, the Son of the living God, I will build my church, which is just phenomenal. Then he goes on, if you remember this, the gates of hell shall not prevail. And he says, I give you the keys of the kingdom. We talked about that. What you stop on earth is stopped in heaven. What you let go on earth is let go in heaven or loosed on earth. And it just comes to this amazing understanding. Last time we were together, if you didn't get that, I don't know that I've heard more people tell me about how they've enjoyed it. Vic, I appreciated your email about that. That was really great. And I just heard so many people just really got so much out of it. I don't know, how many times did you listen to it? It was like, four or five times, just because it was just filled with the things of God, I'm assuming. I hope it wasn't confusing. You just had to listen to it over and over again. I'm assuming you just got something good out of it every time, and that's the Holy Spirit speaking to us. Well, I want to pick up at that last verse, if we can, verse number 20. And he makes a statement right after he says these things to his disciples. That is, and I'm going to read all the way through to the end of the chapter, and then I'm going to come back, and I'm going to explain them one verse at a time until we get this. And that's where the word of God for you personally is going to explode with great revelation. Oh, is that okay? So you're going to have to listen a little bit. I'm going to challenge you, like I said. And I believe the Spirit of God says you're smart enough to listen and follow what's being said. It'll be on the overhead. Starting in verse number 20, it says, and then he commanded his disciples, and they should not tell no one that he was Jesus the Christ. From that time, Jesus began to show his disciples, verse 21, that he must go to Jerusalem and suffer many things from the elders and from the chief priests and the scribes to be killed and to be raised on the third day. And Peter took him aside and began to rebuke him, and saying, far be it from you, Lord, this shall not happen to you. And he turned and he said to Peter, get behind me, Satan. You are an offense to me, for you are not mindful of the things of God, but the things of men. And Jesus said to his disciples, if anyone desires to come after me, let him deny himself and take up his cross and follow me. And whoever desires to save his life will lose it, and whoever loses his life for my sake will find it, verse 26. For what profit is it to a man if he gains the whole world and loses his own soul? Or what will a man give to exchange for his soul? For the Son of Man will come in glory of his Father with his angels, and then he will reward each according to his works. Assuredly, I say unto you, there are some standing here who shall not taste death until they see the Son of Man coming in the kingdom of God. I don't know I'm going to get through all these verses, but I'm going to get through the most important ones for you tonight, so I want you to listen closely. In verse number 20, let's go back there and let's look at it for a second. At first, I started questioning this verse because the verse says something. Here's Jesus. He comes to this planet. Of course, he wants the world to know that he is the Christ, the Son of God. It's very important. He goes around trying to prove that, and he does prove that with miracles, signs, and wonders. He does great things because it's important that the world know that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of the living God. But he does something in verse number 20, and he commands his disciples that you not tell no one that he was the Jesus, the Christ. And I said to myself as I was studying the word of God, and I said it to God, I said, Lord, I just don't understand that verse. You want people to know, but yet you're shutting up your disciples. And the Spirit of the Lord spoke to me the most interesting thing. He says, it's all about timing. If I had my disciples going around saying I was the Christ, the Messiah, the Son of the living God, then I would not have been the only one crucified that day. And they would have taken the 12 of them and crucified every one of them as blasphemers instead of them going out telling the world that he's the Son of God. He said it would have been premature for them to tell the world until I have risen from the dead. And he was doing this because he has a timing for everything. May I say this to you? Sometimes you and I want God to act in a certain way at a certain time. And let's be honest, even question, why haven't you come through? We're tithers, we're lovers of you, been in church all of our life, like you saw with Paul and Vicky tonight on that video. And you say to yourself, what's going on, God? God has a perfect time. And trust is saying, God, I want it now, and I feel like I need it now. I want to do it now. But I know that you have the perfect time, because in your perfect time, it's going to do a whole lot more than if it's being done right now. And for some of you, you just needed to hear that tonight. But something else takes place. In verse number 21, it's really fascinating what starts to happen here, because he not only tells them, don't tell anybody in verse number 20, but verse number 21 comes along and he makes this statement, from that time. In other words, from immediately after he says these words. You know, immediately after he said, you know, Peter, you didn't get that revelation of who I am. You didn't get it from flesh and blood. You got it from my Father who is in heaven. That I am the Christ, the Son of the living God, verse 16 and verse number 17. He says, immediately after he tells him, I'm giving you the keys of the kingdom, you have the authority to stop on earth what will be stopped in heaven, so it won't come to you. And you have the authority also to loose what's on earth instead of what's coming to you. It's a fascinating understanding of the authority that God gives. And then he comes along and he makes this statement in verse number 20. He says these words, don't tell anybody that I'm the Christ, because the timing isn't right yet. But in 21, he starts to tell his disciples something. And what he tells the disciples is the plan of God. The plan of God is shown right here from this very moment. Only a few minutes after he had stopped talking before, he continues talking here and he makes this statement. Jesus began to show his disciples what he must go to Jerusalem and suffer many things there at the elders and the chief priests and scribes, to be killed and to be raised on the third day. The plan was exposed to his disciples at that time. And as you read earlier, Peter hears the plan and Peter does something. He comes along and says, man, that ain't gonna happen at all. And he rebukes Jesus. May I say something? We have heard for years this statement. It's kind of an interesting statement. If Satan knew what he was doing when he hung Jesus on the cross, he wouldn't have hung Jesus on the cross. Can I tell you something? Satan knew he was gonna die in Jerusalem and knew all about the cross and knew he was going to die there and be raised from the dead on the third day, because Satan doesn't have the power to stop the plan of God. And the proof of that is that his disciples are being told the exact plan in verse number 21. In fact, the proof that Satan hears it is how Satan speaks through Peter two verses later. And all of a sudden, we hate this comment. He doesn't know what's going on, or he wouldn't have crucified Jesus on the cross. Oh, yes, he did. This verse tells us that he knew exactly what was going on. But even though he knew what was going on, he could not stop the plan of God. Now, let me tell you something about the plan of God, which is really kind of cool. Maybe you've never thought about this. God knows mankind so well. He knows humanity's frailties, and he knows humanity's faults. And he knows the fall of man. He knows him so well that he can take the negative, the failure of man, and use the failure of man to bring about the plan of God. Because it's in the failure of man that he uses the failure of man. He knew those scribes. He knew those elders. He knew those chief high priests would come along and crucify the Christ. He knew their failure would bring about the plan of God. Let me tell you something. Sometimes we see human failure. We think God's failing. God never fails. He's got this whole thing under control. Come on, somebody. And these verses just scream of this ultimate revelation of God, which is really goes even further than this. And so we see so much by this. He's explaining this. And then verse number 22 comes along. And Peter took him aside. Peter. I think a lot of us can relate with Peter, because we're right there with Peter. I think Peter's in the Bible because probably a lot of us could say, of all of the disciples, we relate more with Peter than we do with any. I know me, I do. I'm not one of the guys that was going to hang around and put my head on Jesus' chest like John. But I am like Peter, put my foot in my mouth. And maybe some of you are that way, because here's Peter about ready to put the foot in his mouth. And he makes a statement, and it's a really fascinating statement that he makes. It's not just something to read through because it says so much about Peter, but it says so much about you. And it says so much about me, mankind in general. Watch this. Peter took him aside and began to rebuke him, saying, "Far be it from you, Lord, this shall not happen to you." Can I just make a statement? Did you not just say 3.5 or 4 verses earlier that you are the Christ, the deliverer, the Son of the living God? And 4 verses later, maybe 4 minutes later, you have now forgot who he was that you said he was? Does that sound like us? Man, one day we're turned on to Jesus, the next day a little problem comes our way and something we don't understand, and what do? Immediately we're like Peter here and we fall apart and we forget the spiritual. One moment he's being complimented. Gee, Peter, flesh and blood has not revealed that I am the Christ, the Son of the living God, but my Father in heaven. Can you just imagine Peter going, "Hey guys, did you just hear what I mean, I'm the guy that got the revelation. This is so cool. My Father in heaven, his father has spoke to me, and I spoke up and I had the revelation." My cool. 4 minutes later, he falls apart. 1 minute he's spiritual, next minute he's carnal and worldly and fleshly. All of a sudden, 1 minute his heart was speaking, and the next minute his mind is speaking. And have you ever noticed something about all of us? We have no problem in operating in the natural. Since our birth, we operate in the natural. When we had a diaper rash when you were young, you cried and mama changed your diapers. In other words, you got a physical response to your physical cry. When you were hungry, you cried. Physically, you got fed and you had a physical response to your physical cry. All of a sudden, here it is. We have no problem. We don't have to think about an answer to something in the natural like Peter. Peter saw something. Peter heard something. He didn't like what he saw. He didn't like what he heard. And now he's going to make a statement, and the statement's going to trip him up. And the statement just voids out a moment ago being spiritual and brings him back to mankind. And it's preserved in Scripture so that you and I can see it. And it's preserved in Scripture so you and I can see it, because what's taking place here is what takes place in all of our lives. Moments that we are spiritual, and then a few moments later, we are so carnal, so natural, we think with our head and not with our hearts. And you know it, and I know it. One day I was in my red truck, and I left church. I had stopped down here by the AMP. I'm getting on the freeway to go east in my red truck, and a lady from the church pulled up behind me. She didn't see it was me, and she didn't notice my red truck, and she didn't know it was me. So I pulled on the on-ramp, and of course, because I knew she was from church, I was not speeding. I was just kind of cool going on the on-ramp. And she got so close to the back of my truck, I couldn't see her headlights. You ever had anybody ride your tail so much you couldn't see her headlights? And I'm thinking, "Guy, sister." And I knew she just came from church, you know. And so I got on the freeway, and she's like, and she couldn't get over that left lane. And she's got her headlights buried in my back of my truck. And I'm kind of like getting ticked off right now, but I can't really do anything because, pastor, you know, if I could make a disguise and then flip her off, I probably would have done it. Do you know what I mean? Because that's the natural part of us, you know, and we're all the same, but that doesn't make it right. Now, let me say it again. We're all the same, but that doesn't make it right. So she gets up and she finally busts in behind, you know how they pop around you this way? And she gets about halfway in past me, and she's so mad at me because I wasn't speeding up. She literally came into my lane. And if I didn't hit my brakes, I would have probably been pushed off of the freeway into the dirt. And I'm thinking, boy, if I ever see that car in church, I am excommunicating them right off. I don't know if I have the ability to do that or not, but I know the church I came from threw people out. I'm going to throw her out. You know, and that's just it. One minute we're spiritual, the next minute, you know, we're driving people off the freeway. Why is that? Because here's why. It's easier for us to act in the natural than to work at acting in the spiritual. We can every now and then do what Peter did, respond to Christ. You know, we're wonderful Christians. You know how we are. We bring our kids to church. We come, hallelujah, sing songs to Jesus, our children, Jesus, and in children's church, you know, and we're holding hands. We haven't held hands in a whole week, but we're holding hands in church, and we're praising God, and everything is wonderful because we're spiritual. Then we get in the car, and the kids stop fighting in the back seats. Anybody done that? And you turn around and say, shut up, you little brats. We just came out of church. What is that? What you went from spiritual to natural. It's easy. Listen to my point. My point is this. It's easy to be natural. We have no problems being natural. And we make excuses that we're all natural, so it's okay when it's not. And that's the point of the development of these verses. So here comes Jesus in this incredible verse. He's being scolded by Peter, who is like, Peter, you got to be crazy. You just said he's the Son of God. He just said he's the Messiah, the deliverer. And now you're going to tell him what to do? Does that not sound like us? We come in, oh, we love you, we praise you, we trust you, God. But, oh, God, I need this money. I want you to do this. I want you to give me that job. I need you to get rid of my boss. I need you to, you know, we do all these things. We tell him what to do. Is that not what he's doing here? He is telling Jesus, the Christ, the living, the Son of God, that is the Son of the living God, what to do, which is just what we all do. But here's what happens. When we do that, there is a response that Jesus has to the whole situation, which takes place, if you will, in verse number 23. In verse 23, he looks at Peter and he makes this statement to Peter, and he turned to Peter and he said, get behind me, Peter. He doesn't say that. He says, get behind me, Satan. In other words, Peter, who just had Satan speak through his flesh to him. Listen, get behind me, Peter, is one thing. Get behind me, Satan, says that Satan was talking to Peter and Peter was listening. Verse 7, 16 and 17 says the Father was talking to Peter and Peter was listening. You are the Son of God, the Christ, the Son of the living God. But in verse number 23, Satan is talking to Peter and Peter is listening. What does that tell you? Let me tell you something. God can speak to us. And also, have you ever noticed? The devil can speak to us. And we listen to God, but we also, because of our flesh, listen to the devil. Is anybody listening tonight? I mean, when we're talking truth tonight, I'm not right. This is truth, that's all. So all of a sudden, we've got to understand that in ourselves, we have the ability to not only hear from God, verse 16 and 17, with a great revelation. But we also have to be cautious because we could be people that rely on the flesh to make responses to the things of life that comes from demonic activity dealing with our natural man instead of our spiritual man. Somebody listening. It's really good to see this. You are an offense to me, he says. In other words, you're contrary to what my plan was that I just told you in verse 21, by the way. And now you're telling me my plan, God's plan, the Messiah's plan for the redemption of mankind is now going to be run by you, Peter. Aren't you glad Jesus didn't say, well, thank you, Peter. I'm so happy. God, I needed you to trust. I need you to save me from this, Peter. It's so good. I don't want to go to the cross. I mean, how stupid is that, that Peter thinks he can change the mind of God? Don't you think that's stupid? We do it all the time. Instead of flowing with the plan of God in His timing for our life that'll bring us to where we need to be, we're always trying to convince God to get to where we want Him to be. And that's what Peter's doing. And Jesus identifies it as, you have just heard from the devil and responding to Satan. Clearly, and He says these words that are really fascinating. And this is the key to everything for the rest of the night. So listen to this. He says, for you are not mindful. Mindful. That means your mind is filled with the things of God. You are not mindful of the things of God, but the things of men. In other words, you operate according to what your flesh says, not according to what God says. And again, it's natural for us to operate according to flesh. We know how to do that real good. We know how to respond. We know how to say things. We know how to act this way. We know how to lose our tempers. We know how to cry. We know how to complain. We know how to get depressed. We know how to get discouraged. We know how to have anxiety. We know how to worry about everything. We know how to operate on any response to us is always oftentimes from the natural instead of from the spiritual. And that is a perfect example of it there. But he says these words, you are not mindful of the things of God. You are mindful of the things of men. And that's the key to everything else. Verse 23 is really a fascinating verse because it's followed immediately with another verse, which, by the way, most of your Bibles have made verse 24, those two little words, like big and bold, so that shows like it's a new thought. Like he has said this, but verse 24 now, look at your Bible, it's like it's a new thought. Here's my question to you. Who says verse 24 is a new thought? The guy that figured out this Bible and said this must be a new thought because it doesn't fit with the other verse 23. So he highlights the verse 24 in your Bible, making it bold so that when we read it, we think it's a new thought coming and it has nothing to do with verse 23. It couldn't because it doesn't relate. And my thing is, are you kidding me? It does relate. You just have to understand it different than you've ever understood it before. Now watch this, you're going to like it. Jesus is still talking. He says these words in verse 24. Jesus says to his disciples, right after he says that about Peter. Here's Peter standing there. He's probably got his mouth open like, oh my God. And the next thing he turns to his disciples and says these words, if anyone desires to come after me. So he like changes the subject? Or does he? Or is he really saying something to all of us? Watch this. I'll let you make the decision. But think about it for a moment. If anyone desires to come after me, let him deny himself. Did Jesus call out Peter because he denied himself, or did he respond to himself? In verse 16 and 17, he responded to the answer to the Father. In verse 23, he responded to Satan. And he moved in his self. And sure, he probably had ideas. I'll save you. I'll take care of you. I love you a lot. I'll even lay my life down for you. All the good things, but it was the wrong things. Yeah. And he says, if anyone desires to come after me, let him put himself aside. In other words, get rid of the fleshly, natural ways of doing things. Take take up your cross. What cross means is this. Oftentimes we don't think of the cross. We think of the cross as something literally that's on there that you're nailed to, okay, that crucifixion. But the cross here is a take up that burdensome act. Take up that burdensome act and follow me. What is the burdensome act? Here's the most burdensome act you will ever have. Let me say it again. Here is the most burdensome act you will ever have. Let me say it again. Here is the most burdensome act you will ever, 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 ever have. If you can overcome this thing, everything else with Christianity, you will fly by. This is the most burdensome act there will be. And it's not the crucifixion on the cross for you. Here's what it is denying your flesh. That cries out with feelings and emotions and wants and desires all the time. So this verse comes along and says, if you'll get rid of what you want and do what I want, if you'll get rid of the natural thinking and the natural mindset and the natural ideas and your fleshly way of doing things and listen to the Spirit like you did in verse number 16 and 17, all of a sudden, now you're going to get blessed. But we take this verse, now we think it's a different thought, and it's not. I present it to you as if it's not. How do I know? Because it follows verse 23. Verse 25 comes along, same thing, talks about it again. Whoever desires to save his life will lose it. But whoever loses his life for my sake will find it. What did he just say? If you want to hold on to your flesh as your guide in life, you're not going to make it. If you want to hold on to the natural and listen to Satan, you're going to come up with dumb things and take you to dumb places, and you're going to wonder what's happening as a Christian, and you're not going to make it. That's what it means. But whoever loses his life, in other words, I put my flesh, my desire, my want, my own insight, my own natural way of functioning, my own mindset about stuff, how do I react to stuff? If I put it aside for his sake, then I'll find what I need, his life. That's what this is all about, because I can't find his life in the natural. I have to find his life in the spiritual. With that in mind, in fact, I can go through all the rest of the verses. They all say similar things. He's really beating this point home. Let's go to verse 26 for an example. In verse 26, what does it profit a man to gain the whole world? What do you care about the natural? That's not going to do a thing for you. And how much you gain in the natural, that's not what this is all about. But watch this, and lose your own soul? Because you follow Satan, you listen to your flesh, you're like Peter in verse number 23, instead of like Peter in verse 16 and 17, all lumped together within a few verses. He says, what have you gained everything but you lost your soul? And what would you give to get your soul back? The next two verses, he solidifies it. Well, here's what I want to show you something. In your walk and in my walk, to get rid of me, I'm going to have to come to a place. Me meaning my natural way of doing things, my flesh, you know, my physical response to evil are things that are contrary to my way, you know, to all things. I need to respond better on the freeway when someone from our church cuts me off personally than thinking about, boy, I'd love to give her a finger. You know, that, and I won't do it because I'm a pastor. I should do it because I love Jesus and I love her. And you see, and with that, me, it's the same thing with you. It's exactly the same thing with all the people you know. Exactly. We do what we do because verse 16, 17, you are the Christ, the Son of the living God, becomes revelation from the Father, not some revelation that penetrates my flesh and I'm full of the mind of the natural world. Watch this. Galatians 5th chapter, Paul writes about it. Verse 16, 17, I think it is 16. If you say then, walk in the Spirit, the word walk, circle in your Bible means live out life. That's the best translation I could possibly give you. Live out life, not just walk. I'm talking about living out life. So he says, I say then, live out life in the Spirit. And you, now tell me if this doesn't fit with Peter. And you shall not fulfill the lust of the flesh. Here's Peter making stupid comments to Jesus, telling Jesus what to do. Oh my God, come on. How dumb can we be? But we do it all the time. Now watch this. He says, you'll not fulfill the lust of the flesh. Is that what Peter was doing? Fulfilling the lust of the flesh? And Jesus called him on it because he was walking not on the spirit, he was walking in the flesh. He walked in the spirit, verse 17, 18. Now let's go to the next verse. For the lust, for the flesh lusts against the spirit, and the spirit lusts against the flesh. And these are contrary to one another. The word lust means war. It wars against, and I'll show you that in just a few minutes. It wars against the things of the, my flesh wars against my spirit. And my spirit says, I cannot work with the flesh. And it keeps me from doing anything so that I do not do the things and wish I could do. So a lot of us are going along in life as Christians, wishing we could do something. We can't do anything because there's something keeping us from the blessings of the spirit. We're operating in the natural man. And if you keep operating in the natural man and God blesses you while you're operating in the natural man, you'll stay in the natural. Guess what? Because you got blessed in the natural. So why would you change if you got blessed in the natural? So God keeps the natural, the blessings from you as long as you're in the natural until you get into the spiritual. It was in the spiritual that you saw Peter get blessed by Jesus. It was in the natural that you see Jesus rebuking Peter. Is anybody listening? And this, so these things work against each other. And Paul writes about it in Romans, the 7th chapter. I think it's verse 22. Let's see if we can pop that up. It says, for I delight in the law, or let's just take the word law and put the word of God in there, or God's word, because that's what we're talking about. We're not talking about the Ten Commandments. Is that okay? Because it's not that. This is New Testament. He says, I delight in the law of God. That's what God says that we're to operate in, okay? The word of God, according to the inward man. In other words, I am happy inside about the things of God. When you come into the church and you hear the things of God, you know what? You're a Christian. You get happy on the inside. But that's not good enough. You can't just stop there. Let's go on. Verse number 23, it makes this. But I see another law in my members. Another word for members is in my flesh, in my carnal thinking, in the ways I do things, in my feelings, in my emotions, in my wills, and my desires in life. Those things that I naturally do. So he says, I see another law. The one law is I'm happy over the things of God, but I see another law, and it operates in my flesh. And he says, warring. See the word warring up there? That's the word from Galatians, the 5th chapter. Warring, lusting, watch, against each other, against the law of my mind. Remember, he said, you are mindful of the things of the world and not mindful of the spirit. And so all of a sudden he says, they war against the mind and bring me into captivity to the law of sin, and which is in my members. And it's naturally for me to operate according to what I feel and what I think and all my emotions. And I'm learning as a Christian how to operate by the spirit and not operate by the flesh. And he says these words, go on to the next verse. He says, oh, wicked man that I am, who will deliver me from this body, this natural man of flesh? And then I love the next part of this verse. He says, I thank God through Jesus Christ. Now, it's interesting that we have deliverance from ourselves. It's the power of the Holy Spirit that dwells on the inside of us that helps us to get into the spiritual and get out of the natural. That's what we all need to understand. He wouldn't tell us to do something if we couldn't do it. God's not a joker that's in heaven saying, ha, 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 look at those stupid little humans like ants. I told them to do those things. They can never do that. He gives us the power to do what he asks us to do. And it's the Holy Spirit on the inside. But most of us don't go to the Holy Spirit for direction. We wait for our flesh to tell us what to do. And that's where we fail in life, because that's our cross, is to get rid of that flesh. Is anybody listening? I love this. Go to, you guys back there, go to Romans, the 8th chapter, verse number 1. He says, there is therefore now no condemnation. In other words, there's no guilt, there's no nothing to a person that does something. Watch what he does. To those who are in Christ Jesus, who do not walk according to the flesh, who do not live out life according to the flesh. You will never be guilty, you'll never be sad, you'll never be down, you'll never be out, you'll never be a loser, what he just said. If you learn how to walk according to the Spirit instead of your flesh. Peter showed us a perfect example of walking in the flesh and also walking in the Spirit. In the Spirit he got blessed by God, in the flesh he got rebuked by God. And the same exact thing happens with us. He says there's no condemnation of those in Christ Jesus who do life according to the flesh, but according to the Spirit. Verse number 2. He said, for the law of the Spirit of life in Christ Jesus has made me free from the law of sin and death. In other words, the things of God set you, your family, your children, your finances, your dream, your future, your destiny. I'm telling you something. There's nothing you can't accomplish with Jesus Christ if you're following God. There's nothing going to stop God. No devil in hell or demon loosed on earth can stop God from his plan for your life if you will just follow the Spirit. Verse 5. You got verse 5 you can pop up for me? For those who live according to the flesh, set their, watch it now. For those who live according to the flesh, that's what Peter did in verse 23. For those who live according to the flesh, set their minds on the things of the flesh. Peter said, man, I don't want to see you crucified. I don't want to see you die. I don't want to see you tortured. I'm going to be your savior. I'm going to come in there and join. He meant well, but guess what? You don't get blessed for well-meaning things. You only get blessed doing God's what he says you to do. Well-meaning doesn't cut it. Are you following me? He says, for those who live according to the flesh and set their minds on the things of the flesh, but those who live according to the Spirit set their minds on the Spirit. And may I say this to you? That's the battle for every one of us. When it's time to respond to something, what does your mind say and what does your spirit say? Now, I'm going to give you three quick things, and I only have 3 minutes. Can you give me 3 minutes, 4 minutes? All right. Three quick things. I had 13 things to do. But I know that Pastor Dan would have a big lasso rope me and pull me off the stage. Three things that you need to understand that will help you, just help you, won't complete it, but it'll help you to stay in the Spirit instead of the flesh, because that's important for you to know. How to live out life in the Spirit is what I call this. So write this down. I'm going to go through them real fast. Number one. You need to understand that you have the ability to imitate him. Everybody say the word imitate. Imitate means you're going to be like somebody. You're going to reflect him like a mirror. As he is on this earth, so are we, the Bible says. He's not talking to other people, he's talking to you. As he is on this planet, so he is, so are you. We have the ability to imitate him. We do not have to imitate Peter, even though he's a great man of God. We don't have to imitate Paul or James or Peter or Paul or your pastor or anybody else. We imitate Christ. Paul even says, imitate me as I imitate Christ. In other words, you're eventually and obviously following Jesus. We have the ability to follow Jesus and not follow our flesh. I want to give you a verse on that. I love this verse. 1 John, the second chapter, verse number 6. 1 John, the second chapter, verse 6 says it like this. He who says he abides in him ought himself also to walk, live out life, just as he lived out life. Would not tell you to do something you can't do. Here's what you need to know. I, by the power of God, can do this. You need to say that. I, by the power of God, can do this. Could you do that? Everybody say this. If you believe this, it's true because he's telling you that. I, by the power of God, can do this. And that's what all of us need to remember every day. Every day I fall. Every day I fail. Every day my flesh wins out. And you know darn well so does yours. But that doesn't make it right. What makes it right is when I get up and make the effort to get back into what God would have me to do, and by his power, I can get back into what God would have me to do. Come on, somebody. The second thing is this word acknowledge. I need to acknowledge that I have a new life. So I need to imitate and I need to acknowledge. I need to acknowledge that I have a new life. I'm not living the old life. I may look like the old person, but I have a new life. I have a new future. I have a new destiny. I have a new purpose. I have a new direction. I have a new life ahead of me. And every day when I get up, I don't have to live the life of the flesh. I can live the new life in the spirit. As long as I know what God has to say, I can live that. And that's why you come to church and you listen to what God has to say and what he's saying to us, so that we can live our lives crucifying that, if you will, carrying up, picking up that cross and following him to the blessings. Come on, somebody. See, and he says, acknowledge new life. I like what it says in Romans. Go there with me in the 6th chapter, verse number 4. Therefore, we are buried with him through baptism unto death, that just as Christ is raised from the dead by the glory of God, we also should walk in the newness of life. God wouldn't tell you to do that if you couldn't. What's the newness of life? Following the Spirit, not following your flesh. Third thing, real quick, and we'll close with this one, is the word operate. Now, you've got three words. First one was imitate. The second one is acknowledge. The third one is operate. Operate in faith about what you're going to do. If you fail, get up and believe God to do it right. Won't be very long before you stop doing it the wrong way and you start doing it the right way. I mean, I used to fight with Debbie and I thought I was winning. Guess what? I found out that I don't win and she doesn't win when we fight. That's a natural, normal thing. Here's what we found out. We found out, shut up. Let's just keep on going with God. That's what this is all about. Let's do what God would have us to do. If there's a time for us to be quiet until we can settle down and have a conversation, then let's settle down. Let's have that conversation. Let's work this out. Stay in love and let's kiss. But you know, you don't stay in the error, you get out of the error, and then by faith you get back into the right thing. I love what the Word of God says, if you will, here in 2 Corinthians, the 5th chapter, verse 7, last verse for tonight. For we walk, live out life by faith, not by sight. Peter made the statement by what he saw and what he heard. Satan comes in and amplifies it. Jesus identifies it as Satan, says, you irritate me. You are more carnal than you know, for you have a mind full of the ways of man and don't have a mind full of the ways of God. And that is the problem with every marriage, every business transaction, every financial situation. That is the problem with almost everything that you have in your life, is you're looking at it from the natural instead of looking at it from the spiritual. Go back and be a verse 16 and 17. You are the Christ, the Son of the living God. Instead of, I'll take care of you, I'm going to rebuke you, here's what you need to do, follow me. Come on, somebody get something out of this tonight. These are good words from Jesus. Yeah, did you get something? Yeah. Because I know I got something. I mean, I just love it. I just got something from God. So I'm just having the time of my life. When we pastored this church, we had 11 services a week. I didn't have time to spend much with God. Whatever I got is whatever I got. But now I get time.
Pastor Dan does all the work, and I get to spend time with God. This is the best thing that ever happened to me. I want to make sure everybody's all right with God before you go. Come on, everybody stay seated. Nobody get up and leave. Here's why, because I'll let you go in just a few minutes, but let's be respectful of the Holy Spirit. The Spirit of God is in this house right now and wants to do something in some personal lives that are in here right now. Listen to what I'm going to say to you. I'm going to shock you with this statement. Hear me. Some of you that are in this room, just like Jesus said, there's some among us right now that will not taste death. That verse is really fascinating. He didn't say they wouldn't die. He just said they wouldn't taste it. They all died. And I'm going to make a statement as blunt as Jesus is to some of you right now. So listen, some of you are going to die and go to hell. And that is really sad. When you don't have to go to hell, you can make the choice to do something. You know, Jesus makes a statement. He says, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man goes to the Father except by me. Now, I don't give a flip what anybody in the world says. There's only one way to heaven, and his name is Jesus. I don't care about all the other religions that say they're the way. I want you to know that Jesus is the only way. The only Son of God, his name is Jesus. And he comes a beaten, bloody mess and dies on that cross just like he said. And his plan was so amazing that he even took the sin of men to fulfill the plan of God. You talk about wisdom. So that you and I could come into this place tonight and receive Jesus Christ really and truly as our Lord and as our Savior. Wow. That you and I could come into this safe and friendly place. We've laughed, we've clapped our hands, we've sung songs, and I think it's great. You are great listening to the Word of God, but tonight, some of you need to get what Jesus says, born again. Jesus in John, the third chapter, says these words, you must be born again. Soon as I say that to any audience in the world, by the way, immediately people turn off because born again people have been betrayed by Hollywood movies and magazines and books as goofy, crazy, and radical and fanatical and just goofballs. But that's not what Jesus is talking about. Born again means this. Here's what it means from the beginning of the Bible to the end of the Bible. It means you've given God all of your heart. You've given God all of your life. I heard two little kids talking not too long ago, a few months back, and one said to the other kid, he says, do you know Jesus? And he says, yes, I know Jesus, the other kid said. And he said, good, then you're saved and going to heaven. It's not true. But we teach the people that if you know Jesus, you're a Christian. It's not true. It's not true. The devil knows Jesus, and he's not a Christian. In order for you to become a Christian, you must be born again. To be born again means you have to do something. You have to give God all of your heart. You have to give God all of your life. Like I said in the beginning, it's all about the heart. This whole book is about the heart. You have to give him your heart. You have to give him your life. He won't steal it from you, won't connive you out of it, won't talk you out of it, won't hit you in the head with a 2x4. He won't make you do it. Someone says, if God wants me saved, he'll make me saved. Oh, no, he's already gone to the cross. What more could he give? Now it's your call. Will you receive him as your Lord, Savior, give all in your heart, give him all your life, be born again, headed for heaven and denying your presence in hell? Let me make a statement to you. It's a great statement. It's all or nothing with God. It always has been. God forgive us in American churches for 250 years. We've watered that down because we're basically afraid of people's faces. We want them to come to church and give money. God forgive us. The bottom line, it's all or nothing with God, and someone needs to love you enough, respect you enough, and honor you enough to tell you the truth, all or nothing. I'll prove it to you, last book in the Bible, the book of Revelation, and you've heard about it. Jesus makes this statement, I'm coming again, and you know he is. And he says, and when I come, I better find you hot or I better find you cold, because if I find you lukewarm, I will vomit you from my mouth. I'll vomit you from my mouth. What a crude, rude statement. When I come and find you lukewarm, I will vomit you from my mouth. What's he saying? He's saying people that are lukewarm are not going to make it. What's lukewarm? Let me identify it. Tell me if it fits your where you're at. Let's be honest with yourself right now. Lukewarm, little in, little out. Little up, little down. Token prayer, occasional church attendance. Here it is. You're not against God, but you're not wholehearted for God. Someone needs to tell you, you're not going to make it. You're not against him, but you're not wholehearted for him. You don't complain about him. You know who he is. But guess what? That's not good enough to get you into heaven. You're going to have to give what he gave to you, all of his heart and all of his life. That's a marriage. That's what works. Nothing else works but that. And then, may I say this to you, then the door is open for you to come home and be born again. And then the Holy Spirit comes on the inside and helps the revelation of understanding what God wants for you. But you can get to heaven after tonight because you're born again. But there's a bunch of you in here tonight that need to give God all of your heart, give God all of your life. And here's what you've been doing. You've been running from God instead of to God. Here's what you've been doing. You're not sure if you're really saved or not saved. You're not against God, but you're not sure. Here's what you've been doing. You know, you think you're okay because you prayed with Billy Graham on television and prayed a prayer, or maybe at a harvest crusade. God bless you for that. But where does it say that you repeat a magical abracadabra formula, call to prayer, and God's so stupid, he sees you and he goes, oh, they said those words. I guess that's heaven for them. He watches your heart and follows your words. See if it follows your words. And if a heart hasn't followed your words, then those words were empty tokens. And tonight you need to give God all of your heart, give God all of your life, and stop messing with God. And there's a bunch of you in here that need to get saved. I'm going to count to three, pop my hands together, and that's it. You're going to raise your hand wherever you're at. You say, if I raise my hand, I'll be embarrassed. I'll be embarrassed. I can't raise my hand. The people I came with saw me. People behind me will see me. Yep. Jesus went to the cross publicly for you. In a safe church like this, you get your hand up for him. Who cares what people think? It's more important to see that God sees you than what people think. And if you're more concerned about what people think, you'll never make it as a Christian anyway. You better be more concerned about what God sees. Tonight is your night of salvation. Every head up and every eye opened. Let's get right with God tonight. Tonight is your night. All across this auditorium, back in the family rooms, wherever you're at, in the foyer, wherever you're at right now, I'm speaking to you out there sitting on the chairs. Listen to me right now. Tonight, you can get your hand up and then tell an usher you raised your hand. All across this auditorium, I'm going to count to three. You've been running from God instead of to God. I'm speaking to you. Never given him all of your heart. I'm speaking to you. Never given him all of your life. I'm speaking to you. If you're not sure, make sure tonight is your night. I'm counting to three as I pop my hands together. You get your hand up. Let me see it. And then put it right back down. And you're making a statement. I don't want to go to hell. I want to go to heaven. And I'll see it publicly. Because Jesus said, if you confess me before men, I'm a man. I'll confess you as mine before my Father. That's what Jesus said, and you can trust his word. He'll do that and keep that. You want him to say that about you. All across this auditorium, are you ready? Here it is. One, two, three. Let me see your hands. Let me see your hands. There's one. Thank you. There's two. Thank you. God bless you. Anybody else real quick? There's three. Thank you. There's four. God bless you. Back over here. There's five, six, seven. Thank you. There's eight. Back over here. Come on. Somebody else. There's nine. Thank you. God bless you. Anybody else? Anybody else? There's nine wise people. Where are you? Ten. Where are you? Ten. You know you need to get your hand up and you're saying, I wonder if I should. You should. Anybody else? Anybody else? There's nine people that got their hand up. If we didn't do what we just did, nine people could have gotten out of here tonight, died and gone to hell, and they're going to go to heaven. There's 10. God bless you. I hope you did that on your own, not because someone told you to do it. But if you did, listen, you just come with a heart that wants Jesus. Anybody else? There's 10 wise people. Anybody else? Anybody else? You're going to miss this. I'm going to call it over with right now. Are you okay with that? 10 wise people. Well, let's give the Lord a great big praise for 10 wise people. All 10 of you, I want you to get a hold of your coat, purse, sweater, Bible. All 10 of you, I want you to get a hold of your coat, purse, sweater, Bible. All 10 of you, I want you to get a hold of your coat, purse, sweater, Bible. You know, they always say old people repeat themselves. All 10 of you, get a hold of your coat, purse, sweater, Bible. Get your stuff, get in the aisle, meet me right here. Now, wait a minute. If you didn't raise your hand, but you know you should have, and there's four of you in this section right in here, I don't know where you are, four of you that need to come. You didn't raise your hand, but you need to come, and you know it. There's three of you that need to give their hand up that you didn't raise your hand, but you know it. The Spirit of the Lord is speaking to me right now. There's seven of you in this room right here that need to come give the Lord all of your heart and all of your life. You didn't raise your hand, but you know it. And back over here, there's three more that you need to give. That's a lot of people, but at least the 10 of you that raised your hand, I want you to come. And anybody that didn't raise your hand, but you know that's you, I spoke to you just now by the Spirit. You better be obedient. Get out of your seat. Get your stuff. Meet me right here in front. Nobody leave yet. I'll let you go in a minute. You come right now. Come, 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 come.
I surrender.
Come on. Come on, come on,
come on. I surrender.
Just come on down here. Come on.
Come to thee, my blessed Savior.
Come on, give the Lord a praise. They're coming. Give them a hand as they come. Come on, you come too. Come. You know you need to come. Come.
Come
on. Oh, they're still coming. Come on, give them a hand. Don't stop yet. Hallelujah. Thank God you guys put a smile on your face. This is the best moment of your life. This is the best moment of your life. And this is the beginning, if you'll follow up with God, the beginning of great things in the things of God. See this guy over here? His name is Pastor Joel. Pastor Joel is a really good guy. No weird stuff, I promise you. He's going to do three things. I'm going to tell you so you don't, you know, think he's weird. He's not. Number one, he's going to pray with you to lead you in a salvation request, that you requesting Christ to come into your heart. That needs to happen. Doesn't happen because you come forward. Doesn't happen you don't get saved because you came to church. Doesn't happen because you clapped your hands or raised your hands or walked down here. It happens because you invite him. He's a gentleman. Invite him into your heart. Number two, he's going to give you some free literature. I wrote a little pamphlet about third grade reading about what to do next. It's called, I love this title, Welcome to Your Destiny. It's being translated right now in Korean. And the Korean churches are using that. I think that's pretty exciting. Welcome to Your Destiny. How cool is that? And then thirdly, he's going to explain to you that we have a program called Spiritual Personal Trainers, where you can meet somebody before church and they'll buy you coffee, tea, nachos, cookies, whatever. And they'll go over five principles. Here's the reason why. After you learn these five principles and you've come to church five times, this will become your church. Nobody's going to keep you from your church. And man, now you got friends, you got family, you understand it, you're comfortable when you come in. That's what this is all about. So don't just come tonight, pray the prayer, and get lost. We want you to come on back. We're putting our application in to be your pastors and help you get strong for the future, because there's a great future ahead of you. So here's what we want you to do. Make a left turn and follow Pastor Joel right over there. Come on, let's give the Lord a great big praise.